antidepressant medications, maybe visits to a psychologist, then the evidence goes more in favor of a depression, which has actually accentuated the menopausal symptoms. But if there is no past of depression symptoms and
yes, ma'am. There was some interruption in the last few sentences, ma'am. Ma'am, you're audible now, ma'am.
Hello?
Ma'am, you're audible now. Hello, ma'am? Am I there? Hello? Hello. Ma'am, we lost your audio actually, ma'am, and video. Okay, ma'am. Okay, ma'am. Sure, ma'am. We'll wait. Sure. Hello, doctors. Ma'am is having a slight technical issue. She will be just back. Be back in a couple of seconds. Hello. Pause panna.
Yeah, Kiran, we are able to hear you. That not
only so we will be back in just a few seconds, doctor. So just pause the meeting since ma'am is back.
Yeah, you are audible, Dr. Kiran.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, are you there?
Yes, I'm there. I'm really apologies to the crowd for the drop in technology.
I totally understand, ma'am. These things tend to happen.
Yeah. So hopefully this should not happen again, and Yeah. So I'm just continuing from where I stopped earlier. I'm not sure where I stopped, but I will just still respond.
Please, ma'am.
We have to. Hello.
Ma'am, yes, ma'am. You're audible now, ma'am.
Yeah. So just to continue from where I have stopped earlier. I think I was talking about the difference between depression and anxiety. Dr. Kiran, I'm getting an echo. I don't know why.
Ma'am, is it okay now?
Yeah, it's better now.
Okay.
So just to continue from where I stopped, there is a very thin line of demarcation between depressive symptoms in women undergoing menopause and the actual menopausal symptoms. One of the clinical ways in which one can distinguish would be to look for a past history of depression. If there is a history of either being treated for depression or having episodes of depression in the past or having, you know, taken antidepressant medications and all, then one would favor a diagnosis of depression at that point in time. But if there is no past history, I think importance should be given to the menopausal symptoms and treat the woman accordingly.
Thank you, ma'am. I think you actually clarified a big enigma, ma'am, because depression and the symptoms of menopause usually tend to overlap.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah. Sometimes we actually need co-treatment.
Definitely.
Co-treatment, and I think judicious decision must be taken in the consulting room of the gynecologist whether to refer them to a psychiatrist or not. And maybe we should elucidate that as well. When do you refer to a psychiatrist as we go by?
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, in continuation with our discussion of the symptoms which we spoke about, normally, ma'am, in menopause, there are symptoms which are oft repeated, or say 50 to 60% of these patients actually have these symptoms. So what I'm talking about is symptoms like brain fog, vaginal symptoms, hot flushes are common. So sometimes they're viewed actually as being psychosomatic. Can you actually help us understand these symptoms better, ma'am?
Yeah. See, this term psychosomatic is an extremely, is a much debated terminology. I know most textbooks of psychiatry talk about psychosomatic medicines. But then psychosomatic conditions, disorders, there are plenty of them, right? Even diabetes, in fact, is called as a psychosomatic condition in the psychiatric parlance. Okay. Now, the important thing would be is to evaluate the woman biologically. I mean, is it that the drop in estrogens that is making her experience such symptoms? Because sometimes, what is evidence-based practice is the use of hormone replacement therapy. And the basis for hormone replacement therapy is to protect the woman against the dropping estrogen levels, right? But then sometimes what happens is that, although there is a lot of debate about that as well, and the side effects of HRT are often cited as, not really contraindications, but something that physicians should be, aware about. What happens with these biological symptoms or physical symptoms of menopause is that a depressive state can actually accentuate many of these symptoms. To give you a classic example, a woman who is experiencing vaginal symptoms very often could be mistaking it for problems with a sexual interaction. A dry vagina, dyspareunia is a very common thing in menopausal women, and I'm sure many gynecologists have to answer questions to the woman about her own sexual functioning. Libido, drop in libido is a very common symptom. And we have noticed that a woman who's very preoccupied with her vaginal symptoms often needs to discuss her sexual life, right? And understand why there is dyspareunia, why there is a dry vagina, and so on and so forth. So it does involve a lot of communication with the patient to try and understand her symptoms. It need not necessarily be her emotional distress, right? Although, and the other thing that I would like to clarify here is, in India, and in many of these more, not the older civilizations, like you'll find this very common in Africa, in many of the, old European populations, where physical symptoms of depression predominate against the emotional symptoms. So a woman would come to me with chronic headache, but the underlying problem would be a depression. Woman would come with, I'm using woman here because as we're talking about women, this is not uncommon for men as well, to present with physical symptoms. So in India, several epidemiological studies which have talked about how physical symptoms are more common. In fact, a lot of them complain of aches and pains, right? And aches and pains is a very, very common thing, and which the physician can never understand why there is an ache all over the body, right? Different parts of the body. It could be stomach, it could be limbs, etc. So we do have depression presenting with physical symptoms as even normally, right? So a woman in menopause, her physical symptoms can get sometimes exaggerated when there is a comorbid depressive condition, right? So what happens is that we could actually be ignoring her physical symptoms because we think that the woman is depressed. I've had many women referred to me. I mean, they've been seeing, maybe a family doctor, or they may be seeing their gynecologist several times, and they would be referred to me saying that this woman is depressed, chronically depressed, and they would come to me with a note saying chronic depression. But for all you know, today's life event in that woman's life could be she's menopausal. So we should use our clinical judgment to be able to distinguish between whether we can treat her with, hormone replacement therapy for her physical symptoms of menopause rather than that of depression. Again, I'm not ruling out co-therapy, right? You could treat a woman with HRT and an antidepressant medication, but that, of course, is left to the practice of the individual physician who's dealing. When I mean physician here, I'm talking both about the psychiatrist and the gynecologist, right? For a common terminology, I'm using the word physician here.
Right. Thank you so much for shedding light on that. Ma'am, we spoke a lot about emotional symptoms. So for many of these women, these emotional symptoms tend to appear suddenly. Can you tell us why this happens?
Yeah, actually, there is an interesting explanation for this. Earlier, remember I told you that, this awareness of menopause can actually become a kind of a sudden recognition simply because the woman was busy all through her life. She was doing this, that, and everything else. And so, sometimes she fails to pay attention to the signals that her own body is giving. And suddenly one day she realizes, hey, I could be menopausal. Okay, there are a number of instances where this happens. Suddenly she'll realize I've not got my periods for about 6 months now, right? I mean, she's just been so busy that she's just not acknowledged what her body is signaling for. It's not really a true sudden onset. It is, I would say, rather a sudden recognition or acknowledgement of a problem. And it actually like zooms into, multiple symptoms that she might have at that. So I get women saying, only for the past 15 days have I been depressed. It's not true that it's only past 15 days. If you actually probe a lot more, which is where we psychiatrists come into play, as we tend to, ask a lot of questions, we do know that this depression has been there for over a long period of time. Menopausal symptoms may have been there over a period of time, but she just failed to recognize it. So rather than talk about it as a sudden onset, I would like to say it's a sudden recognition or sudden acknowledgement of the problem.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Ma'am, generally, the other important aspect is when you say menopause, there is this loss of periods which can lead to confusion. There is a fear of menopause or what's going to happen. There is a sense of loss of femininity in the women. And most important is a fear of aging. So how does one come to allay these fears in general, ma'am?
Yeah, so I think today this would probably be seen in women. I mean, my gynecologist friends can of course beg to differ on this, but my clinical observation is that the young girls of today, when they become menopausal, may not experience this so much because there's a lot more awareness of the biological cycle. But say a woman who's, say, now between her 50s to 60s, did not really get too much of education on the life cycle, reproductive systems, sex life and all, when she was in school. Maybe all that she learned was from her grandmother, from her mother, and so on and so forth. So the awareness for the woman who's in the menopausal period today, you can say that, you know, there's a lot of panic about, you know, not getting her next period, panic about what will happen to her in the future and things like that. Usually, my experience is this is a very time-bound kind of anxiety, right? Maybe she's not got a period for 6 months and she will blame, you know, she might have also gained weight around that time. And so she will say, I'm menopausal, therefore I have gained weight. But it's likely that, you know, she is, she might be a lot more worried about, see, one of the common concerns that I've had is that, you know, will I have cancer of my uterus, right? There have been several women who have asked me this question, you know, cervical cancer, I've never had a pap smear done, I've never taken a vaccine, which young girls today take, would I get cancer because I've not got my period, right? So one of the, I think what we need to do is to educate women that an annual gynec check, like you do an annual medical check, perhaps will keep you on the path of understanding this whole menopausal issue. So I do recommend that, you know, even if a woman comes to me at 40 with depression, I said, all that is fine, I'll help you take care of your depression, but I think you must have a regular gynec check, right? It is possible that everything is normal, but nevertheless, go and meet your doctor at least once a year, right? So what happens is this allows the gynecologist an opportunity to discuss with the woman on the possible onset of menopause and preparation time. You know, the woman is allowed to get some knowledge, and then maybe she'll go and Google and get more information and so on and so forth. But definitely, any woman who over the age of 40 who comes to me, I strongly urge them to get a gynec check at least once in a year. There is no scientific rationale or there's no research evidence to indicate the value of the follow-up. But I think at a clinical level, visiting a gynecologist would be a sound practice by the woman. And that's what I recommend to women who come to me at that age. Right? So then when they are around menopause, they don't have to. We are rather working at preventing symptoms related to panic surrounding loss of periods, you know, all the menopausal symptoms. We are trying to prevent it. Now, as far as dealing with the problems go, I think one is, of course, conversations with the woman around it, which can be done by either physician, or there could be a chance that this woman actually can be referred to a psychiatrist or a psychologist. And there are certain specific conditions when you can refer to a psychiatrist, which we will talk about in the following questions.
Thank you, ma'am. You gave a short prelude to the next questions also to the audience. So actually, ma'am, my next question to you is, how can gynecologists help women to accept the state of emotional distress in this phase of the life cycle, ma'am? What are the general things which they can do?
Yeah, this is again a very interesting question and a question which I hope, you know, the take home message out here is that I know most gynecologists are pretty busy in their practice. You have maybe, you know, a lot of patients waiting out in your OPD and many of them, like, you know, in advanced stages of pregnancy and a lot more, you know, emergency kind of situations are there. But so one of the things that you could try and do with these women is, as I told you, nothing replaces a good conversation. And if you are able to allocate time to educate this woman on the menstrual cycle, menopause, the emotions related to menopause, nothing can replace that. But in the event that you do not have time, maybe I think your waiting room could have information related to menopause and mental health lying around there, so that, you know, in maybe, you know, the different languages depending upon where you are coming from, so that there is some education for the woman to know that, you know, there is a likelihood that it could be mental health problems. And the more important information is that this is time bound. This is not going to last forever. It's that, you know, you're not seriously mentally ill just because you're having a symptom. That information, if my gynecologist friends can communicate, it would definitely help the woman to not panic about mental health symptoms. The panic is not just related to having a menopause. The panic is also related to whether I can turn mentally ill because of my symptoms. And you can allay those symptoms by just giving them a lot of information. Right? And if they are asking you questions that maybe you don't have the time to answer, it might be a good idea to refer them to a mental health professional. You know, I think we spend a lot more time talking to the people or listening to them. So definitely, it could be possible that they would be reluctant to come to a psychiatrist, right? So the other option there could be is, you know, today in many OBGYN setup, I do find that they do employ psychologists for various reasons. It could be to help the woman through her pregnancy, infertility, whatever, even during menopause. So a psychologist would be a good bet to listen to the woman's problem and maybe explain to her certain things. So that's another thing that you could think about doing. But really nothing replaces a nice conversation with the I would still call her a young woman, even though she is menopausal. And you, please spend that little time, because nothing replaces that. You know, and they do go away feeling assured. So the message that has to be communicated is, number one, yes, these could be hormone related. Number two, it is that it's a very time bound thing. And number three is that you're not going to be classified as mentally ill just because you have a symptoms which is, say, indicative of a depressive disorder or what, you know, things like that.
Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, my other question is, since you spoke about these general things or specific things on how the gynecologist can counsel a patient. Now, when it comes to referring a patient to a psychiatrist, ma'am, what are the different setups where a gynecologist needs to refer a menopause patient to a psychiatrist?
Yes. Now, I also noticed that there is one question by Dr. Supriya here on postpartum depression and psychosis. This is a good time to talk about all that. See, any woman has the prevalence of mental health disorders right through the life cycle. You know, a woman has as much chance of getting a mental health problem as the general population is. In different life cycle, different parts of the life cycle, there are different kinds of emotional problems that can happen. The minor, I'm going to retract the word minor, because to the person who's experiencing it, it is 100%, right? You have problems related across the board, anxiety, depression, generalized anxiety disorder, panic attack, phobia, obsessive compulsive disorders, depressive disorders. These are some of the issues which are very, very common amongst different people. Depression is known to be more common amongst women than men. But the more serious conditions like schizophrenia or bipolar disorder, or even these days we're seeing a lot of substance use disorders amongst women, these are again some of the major mental health problems which has to be treated by a psychiatrist. Okay, now when do you refer? If you think that stress because of a mental health problem are quite severe and will require more professional handling, you have to take an immediate step to refer her to your psychiatrist friend. I'm sure some psychiatrists would have passed out in your same batch, so you can easily refer them to a psychiatrist. Now, what happens is some of these problems are kind of self-limiting. When you're looking at, see, something like schizophrenia, bipolar disorder is clearly evident. You don't have to, think twice. You can actually refer them immediately, right? So sometimes it is good to look at, if especially if a person with schizophrenia is also pregnant, right? Then you might want to co-treat the person with the psychiatrist, right? That postpartum depression, I mean, the woman delivers and then there is a depression postpartum. Depression is common. It's very common amongst the women. It's about 65% according to statistics. So usually it is self-limiting. It lasts for about 3 months or so. Usually treatment, you know, the woman gets used to pregnancy, feeding. She's so busy in the postpartum period that the depression often goes away. It doesn't create too much of a problem. But if there are symptoms like she's refusing to feed the baby, or she's, you know, refusing to get out of bed because of her mood state, then I think, or she has unexplained fears. You know, a lot of women have this fear, somebody will snatch my baby away, or my baby will die soon, right? My baby is not feeding properly and I'm responsible for it, right? So these are some of the things that you might want to immediately, you know, refer her to a psychiatrist and maybe a psychologist as well, because treating her in this important period of the baby's life is extremely, we know that the first few months of the baby's life is very, very important for the child's growth, and the woman has to be well for that. And so it might want to refer her immediately to a psychiatrist. Postpartum psychosis, again, presentation is quite clear. There are a lot of psychotic symptoms like hallucinations and delusions and so on. And the woman definitely needs to be treated by a psychiatrist. One question that is often, you know, in the minds of both the patient as well as the gynecologist is use of antidepressant, antipsychotic medications, right? Let me assure my gynecologist friends here that many of the molecules that are available, newer molecules that are available today, are quite safe for breastfeeding, safe for the woman as well, and therefore co-treating her with an antipsychotic or an antidepressant. Of course, we should know the timing of, you know, giving the medications and so on, is absolutely indicated. And like I told you, I would rather have a well woman to deal with the infant baby rather than, you know, say that antipsychotic medications can cause harm and therefore I'm not going to refer to a psychiatrist. The woman continues to remain depressed, it is the baby who is going to suffer in the long run, right? So postpartum, differentiating between depression, the presentation, I mean, psychotic symptoms will be there in postpartum psychosis. Of course, for postpartum psychosis, even a chronic, even a depressive disorder can present with psychosis. So it's up to the psychiatrist to find out if it's a schizophrenia type of psychosis or a depression type of, or a mood disorder kind of a psychosis. So that's the key way you differentiate. And actually, the moment you spot the symptoms, it might be better to refer to a mental health professional rather than keep her untreated. Remember, we are treating her not just for her welfare, but for the welfare of the baby as well, of the newborn baby as well.
So, ma'am, since you spoke about psychiatric drugs, what are the psychiatric drugs that can be prescribed in menopause? So, if you can shed some light on the role of SSRI and gabapentin, etc., ma'am.
Yeah. Usually, it's SSRIs that are more prominently used. You don't use so much of gabapentin you wouldn't find psychiatrists prescribing them. Although, there are indications for the use of gabapentin even in menopausal symptoms. Now, in SSRIs, all range of SSRIs that are available today, SSRIs, SNRIs, all these drugs are usually indicated. I mean, they all have equal efficiencies, right? There is not much of a difference between one molecule and the other. There are some differences in terms of contraindications. If a woman is very depressed and suicidal, one thing that I forgot to mention earlier was if you find that a woman is suicidal, you know, whenever she comes in contact with you, please refer her immediately to a psychiatrist, because we have to give it a lot of credence, a lot of importance, because we never know when they can impulsively end their lives. So like molecules such as fluoxetine are generally contraindicated in suicide, but then there are a whole lot of other molecules like nitazepine, sertraline, which are equally effective, and we normally make a choice of an antidepressant medication of an SSRI depending upon the profile of the individual. For example, if the woman is extremely overweight, then I might think twice before prescribing a sertraline or a nitazepine. We have to also take into account their metabolic status in terms of diabetes or their lipid profile. These are some of the things that would depend, that would define the choice of an antidepressant medication. One of the things that we normally find that if a woman is lactating in the postpartum period, you know, I would not use a benzodiazepine for sleep, because remember it is secreted in breast milk and it could have a negative effect on the child. So I normally would not prescribe a benzodiazepine. I would try to think of an antidepressant which has sedation quotient, like the tricyclic antidepressant. It could be imipramine, it could be dorthopine, it could be amitriptyline, whichever. Amitriptyline is quite safe in this period, so that would be a important drug in the postpartum period. Since there was a question on postpartum, I thought I should also refer to that.
Surely,
ma'am. Postpartum period, we would treat her as we would treat any kind of depressive disorder. The only problem that a woman can face is, see, remember, there's a whole lot of drying symptom, vaginal dryness, and many of them also, you know, talk about mouth being very dry during the menopause, although it's not directly related to menopause, and giving them a tricyclic antidepressant can make them actually feel worse. So we have to be judicious in our choice of medication. Sometimes, you know, today there's a lot of preference given to antipsychotic medications in this period, because they're actually a little safer than the antipsychotic molecules such as quetiapine if the woman is not diabetic, olanzapine. These are some of the drugs which are also known to have antidepressant properties. And there is a trend to use antipsychotic medications as well in this period.
Thank you, ma'am. I think you clarified extensively on the drugs.
You asked about gabapentin. Because I don't think any of my patients come to me really want to use gabapentin. I indicated
patients. Thank you, ma'am. Ma'am, if we go to the moving from menopause slightly away from the other end of the spectrum, if you have women who already have psychotic or psychoaffective or bipolar disorders, once they reach menopause, ma'am, do they have a more worsening manifestation of these vasomotor and physical symptoms? Like, for example, ma'am, one study I read, it was done in perimenopausal and menopausal women with a small sample set of about 100 patients. So what it says on this, we use this quality of life questionnaire, ma'am, menopause severity quality of life. And there, many of the symptoms they found that were actually worsening in manifestation in these women compared to a normal woman or normal class of women reach menopause. Your thoughts on that?
Yeah, see, any woman who has experienced, it's all, a lot of it is to do with perception of the problem, right? For example, if there is an underlying subclinical depression or even clinical depression in a woman through major part of her several decades she has experiences, but without any access to any proper treatment processes. Remember, around menopause, the likely, and I told you earlier that many of our depressive patients actually present with somatic complaints. Okay, so then their symptoms are actually going to be exaggerated during the period of menopause. It's not just because of worsening of depression, but added on estrogen deficiencies, which is causing the menopause, can actually, because the pathophysiology of depression in menopause has been cited as low estrogen levels, right? So definitely, you know, it can get exacerbated during the period of menopause. Okay, and quality of life. Definitely, when somebody is feeling down and low and having experienced a whole lot of problems, one would measure their quality of life as much, a little lower than what it could have been had the woman been symptom-free. Okay, so we do know that there is a dip in the quality of life around this, but I would also say that this is a very time-bound thing. After a period of time, the woman gets used to this whole idea of menopause. Maybe, you know, depending upon the rest of her life situation, quality of life can increase.
Thank you. Probably one last question we can take before we go to the questions. Ma'am, one important area is to do with sexual functioning around the period of menopause. Can you throw some light on this, ma'am?
Yes, this is now extremely critical period of extremely important question to answer. And I think, unfortunately, a lot of us physicians and also including psychiatrists in this is, we refrain from talking too much about this area of sexual functioning with our patients, right? So what happens is, remember, the woman, as she grows old, her husband's libido may not change at all through the life cycle for various reasons. He continues to have an active sexual desire, right? But this woman, because of vaginal dryness, because of dyspareunia, there is a problem with her sexual activity. Depression itself is known to reduce sexual desire, right? So what happens is, she finds that, you know, the husband's attempts at sexual interaction, she finds it very painful, right? And there have actually been men who have come and told me that, look, her interest in sex has died down, but I have nowhere else to go, right? And I do need my sexual release. And so it does cause a whole lot of interpersonal conflict, marital conflict between the husband and the wife. And we do need to deal with this in a very gentle manner, right? Now, trying to get the woman to, you know, look at sexual activity as an absolutely biological phenomenon. I mean, it is not just to do with some kind of, it'll actually, you know, influence their relationship in a big way. Remember, at that time, the birds have flown the nest and possibly they're just husband and wife at home, right? And there's nobody else there, right? And sometimes sex is the main bone of contention between the two of them, and much of it could be explained by the menopause. And there again, I think we do need to sit and talk to the woman and try and explain to her. Of course, they would sometimes, you know, the woman might actually use this as, I remember a case where this woman comes to me around menopause, there were all symptoms, she was referred to me by a gynecologist. She did have depressive symptoms, her husband actually came and told me alone that there was a problem with their sex life. So when I was talking to her about her sex life, she said that this is the only chance she got to hit back at her husband, who was actually a terrible person through her marriage. A lot of domestic violence, a lot of beating, a lot of suspiciousness and so on. She said, this is the only control I have over him. So please do not counsel me to have sex with him. That was her opening statement. And I think I have to give importance to her experience as well. He had to, you know, sit and talk to the husband and explain to him. And of course, they did make things, and things became better after a while. But the sex is an important, and remember, it's the time of their lives, right? There are, of course, women who are happy in their sex life because now they're not bothered with pregnancy and so on. And there are gynecologists who have been advising women on use of lubricant gels for their vaginal dryness and so on. So it's not that everybody comes to us. But I think most people who get referred to us, sexual activity is one of the critical symptoms that we have to deal with.
Thank you so much, ma'am. So ma'am, my last question, if I can look at the whole spectrum of discussion we had today, if I can use this word, ma'am, in terms of psychiatric vulnerability, so we have the onset of menopause, then we have the onset of puberty, pregnancy, postpartum depression, which Dr. Supriya also spoke about, and then menopause. So how would you rank menopause amongst these different segments, ma'am?
As a vulnerability? No, like I told you earlier, see, a woman in menopause is as vulnerable to develop a problem as the general population. It is her individual vulnerability that contributes to the onset of any psychiatric problems. See, in mental health, we talk about women being, we talk about people being vulnerable to develop a particular disorder. I mean, same as in cancer, not everybody develops cancer. One has to have the, you know, genetic and environmental vulnerability to develop a particular disorder, and that's the same is true with even psychiatric conditions. So if a vulnerable woman, when I mean by vulnerability, it could be in terms of genetics, where there is a family history of a mental health problem, which increases her possibility of developing a disorder. There could be environmental issues, like I talked about domestic violence and various other conditions, that will increase her vulnerability to develop a psychiatric disorder. Right? So it's not that every woman who goes through menopause develops psychiatric problems. Right? It's only a small portion that develops psychiatric. I think that it's about 23 to 26% who will develop a psychiatric problem. So it's not that every woman is vulnerable. Right? The vulnerability depends upon the gene environment interactions in that woman's life. Right? So it's not that menopause has an increased vulnerability to develop a psychiatric disorder. I would rather word it this way, that any woman is as vulnerable as the general population to develop psychiatric conditions. Phases of the woman's reproductive life can contribute to a psychiatric problem depending upon her individual vulnerability.
Thank you, ma'am. I think very long discussion. So I would like to thank you for this wonderful, wonderful discussion and also your time, ma'am. I think you have another webinar to catch. I would like to open up a small section called as polls. Before we go to the question and answer session with ma'am, so there is a section called as polls where we want to know about your experience, audience, on what are the different things and treatments and what are the symptoms you see in your clinical practice, and what are the types of webinars which you would like us to conduct. So Chitra, probably you can start the polls now.
So what do I do?
Ma'am, since we are the co-hosts, we cannot participate in the poll.
Okay, excellent. So it's your audience poll. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Probably I'll just take a couple of minutes and then we can come back to the Q&A.
Sure.
I request the audience to scroll down so that all the questions are visible. There are only 6 questions in all.
Yes, so probably we can move into the Q&A section. Doctor, I would like to ask you to ask questions to ma'am. You can type it in chat and we can discuss with ma'am. Any questions around the topic, doctors? Any question to ma'am, doctors on this subject? I would like to share my thoughts on this session. I think, thank you so much, ma'am, for sparing your time. Thank you, ma'am, for addressing gynecologists. I'm sure everybody enjoyed and appreciated the different facets of menopause and psychiatric health, which we explored and discussed with your immense knowledge as well. Thank you so much, ma'am. And I would like to thank the audience also to participate and have a patient listening, to this very important discussion. Thank you, everyone, for logging in.
May I also join Dr. Kiran in thanking Dr. Padmavati and his esteemed audience today.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot, ma'am.
Yeah, sure. Thank you.